Good morning. My name is Preston Watkins. I'm the pastor here at Ashley Mueller First United Methodist Church, and I want to welcome you to our worship this Sunday from wherever you find yourself at this day and time. It is so good to be with you. I just have a few announcements before we get started. The first is about something going on in our community. The Ashley Mueller Area City Schools, Lakeside High School in particular, has launched their Graduation Guardians program, and they've extended that to members of the community. And they really need mentors. The idea is that people from the community will help mentor seniors getting ready to graduate this year. And there is a need for mentors. There is an opening. So if you want to invest into the life of a young person in our community, if you want to pour yourself into a young person and help them succeed, you can get in touch with us and we'll connect you with the school, or you can go to Lakeside High School's website and you will find a kind of interest survey to fill out for the Graduation Guardians program, and I would encourage you to do that. You don't have to have a particular expertise. You don't have to be a master craftsman or a craftsperson. You just need to be yourself. You need to be authentic and just have that time and that support that you're willing to pour into a young person, and you have no idea how much that will mean to them and help them succeed in whatever they plan to do next. So if you're interested at all, please consider lending yourself to the Graduation Guardians program. With regards to our service today, in the middle of our service, we have a time of communal prayer. And if there is a prayer concern or a joy, something you'd like to lift up to God and want the community to lift up to God, please share that with us. You can share it in a myriad of different ways, whether you give us a call or send us an email. You can even leave it as a comment to this video. We'll comb through it and try to find it. Just please let us know if we have permission to share that publicly. If we do, then we certainly will, believe you me. But if not, please rest assured that it will be included into my private prayer life as well as our prayer team here at Ashley Mueller First. It'll be in their prayer lives as well. You'll also notice that unlike worship services that were just in person, we don't have a time where we collect an offering. So what I'd like to do and just take this time and just encourage you that if you find these services impactful or meaningful at all, if you find that in your time with us you walk just a little closer with God each and every day, if you believe in the mission of what we're doing here, to bring Jesus Christ to the people of Ashley Mueller, but in the same way to bring the people of Ashley Mueller to Jesus Christ, I would like to encourage you to give whatever God could be calling you to give. You'll find our tithe.ly link in the description to this video. That is our online giving platform. You're also able to give us a call or send us something in the mail, and we can work with you on the best way to provide something. There is no gift too small that God can't use to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of this city here in Ohio. So with all that aside, without any further ado, let us prepare our hearts and our minds for worship. Would you pray with me, please? Gracious and loving God, in the myriad of places we find ourselves, in the myriad of emotions and states we find ourselves in this time, we ask that your Holy Spirit come and meet us where we are. Fill us with your divine presence. Let us understand what it is to have your image dwell within us and come alive in this time. May you fill this place and make it holy. May you fill us and make us holy. Give us the strength to give the entirety of our hearts, our minds, our bodies, and our souls to the worship of you today, the living God. Amen. Thank you.
Psalm 62, we're going to read verses 5 through 12. Find rest, O my soul, in God alone. My hope comes from Him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. My salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. Trust in Him at all times, O people. Pour out your hearts to Him, for God is our refuge. Low-born men are but a breath. The high-born are but a lie. If weighed on a balance, they are nothing. Together, they are only a breath. Do not trust in extortion or take pride in stolen goods. Though your riches increase, do not set your heart on them. One thing God has spoken, two things have I heard, that you, O God, are strong, and that you, O Lord, are loving. Surely you will reward each person according to what he has done. This is the word of God for the people of God.
As we come together for our time of prayer, let us remember the names of those in our community who we hold dear in our hearts at this time. Jean Knapp, Elaine Richardson, Brent Bunnell, and Linda Down. And a friendly reminder that if you too have something that you'd like to lift up and share, that you are welcome to share it. Once again, just let us know if we have permission to share it publicly. If so, we will. And if not, it will remain in the private prayer lives of myself and of our prayer team here at Ashtabula First. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we come before you wondering what to do next. A new year is upon us, filled with so many fantastic opportunities, and we are not sure which ones to take. Give us ears to listen for your voice. Let us hear where you are calling us. And once we have heard you, give us feet to follow. Allow us to walk in the path that you have made level for us. For those whom we love who are in the hospital, who find themselves recovering, we ask that you send your presence out to them, O God, that in their dark moments, let them see your light that they know they are never truly alone. And if there be a way, O God, that we could ourselves become emissaries of your love, of your comfort, not just to those whom we care about, but to all people, God, we ask that you conspire with us to make it so. Empower us and encourage us to be the people whom you have called us to be. Oh Lord, at this time we come to you as a community made up of individuals. Each of us filled to the brim with your image. Yet each of us carries our own burdens. Burdens that we do not share with others. Burdens that we almost feel obligated to carry. Oh God, let us come to you in the silence of this following time to give those burdens to you, knowing that you will walk with us and you will see us through to the end of whatever problem we are carrying, that you will always lighten the load. And so now we come to you in silence, knowing that you alone have the power to hear these prayers, and you alone have the power to respond. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for the bits of joy we encounter in our life, the rays of sunlight that come down on an otherwise cold and snowy day, for the opportunities we have to be with loved ones, even if we cannot physically be with loved ones. We thank you for the moments in which love and light prevails over the overwhelming darkness and hatred we encounter in this world. We ask that you give us eyes to see more of these little glimpses of your kingdom breaking through into our world today. May we be empowered by what we see and encouraged to keep it moving, to pay it forward, to pass it on, to see your kingdom at work and make it so. We give you thanks for the gifts you have given us through your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Word made flesh to dwell among us, you taught us how to love ourselves. And better yet, you taught us how to love our enemies as ourselves. You taught us how to prepare our lives, how to order ourselves for your kingdom coming. You gave us glimpses into a life that could be lived, in which your love had the final word in all things. And through your death and resurrection, you prove to us that there is something more in store for us, that we, in partnership with you, have the potential to become so much more, deeper, complex, beautiful, an entirely new creation. And so, in recognition of all these gifts that you have given us and will continue to give us, we join together in the prayer that you have taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the glory and the power forever. Amen.
our second reading this morning, we are turning to the book of Jonah. The third chapter, we'll be reading the first through fifth verses and the 10th verse. Jonah 3. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Go to the great city of Nineveh and proclaim to it the message I give you. Jonah obeyed the word of the Lord and went to Nineveh. Now Nineveh was a very important city. A visit required 3 days. On the first day Jonah started into the city, he proclaimed, 40 more days and Nineveh will be overturned. The Ninevites believed God. They declared a fast, and all of them, from the greatest to the least, put on sackcloth. When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he had compassion and did not bring upon them the destruction that he had threatened.
Gracious and loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable and pleasing unto you, for you alone are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So we are continuing our journey through different stories, different authors, different works of literature within our scriptures to see where God's creativity is present and how it manifests itself and how can we channel that creativity ourselves. Oh, I've come undone. The first time that's happened. But it happens all the same. And maybe it's fitting that I look a little silly or funny getting up here, because the way I want to approach the story of Jonah may be a little different than what you've encountered when you've encountered Jonah's story. And I want to start here because this can sometimes be a big point of conflict. And that I'm going to be approaching the story of Jonah. Jonah's not a big story. We're going to be able to tackle all of it, thankfully, because it is literally just 2 pages, not even. It's hard for you guys to see it, but it starts here, ends here. That's Jonah, not much. I'm going to be approaching Jonah as a work of satire. And I will explain that later and kind of how I see it presenting itself as satire. But one of the big questions that then gets risen is, well, if you think it's satire, then it means that at some point you don't think it literally happened. And if you were making that assumption, you'd be correct. That is the stance and opinion I hold on the book of Jonah. I do not believe it is probable that it happened as it's told here. And so the next question that follows that would be, what's the point then if you don't think it literally happened? And I want to start by saying, if you are sitting here and you feel that I am completely disagreeing with everything that you've held about the story of Jonah, or if you think that it is wrong to take something in Scripture that is not literally, I understand. I don't necessarily think it is wrong to take the story of Jonah literally. One of the very interesting and fascinating to me things about studying biblical texts as a whole, regardless of what it is that there are so many different ways to interpret and to see a passage or a story in our scriptures. There's a fantastic metaphor. If I could remember who said it, I would give you that person's name. But essentially the idea is that scripture is like a gem. And each way you turn it, the light reflects off it a different way, meaning that there can be many different ways to see a scripture. And so I want you to hear from me, that just because I see it differently than you does not mean that you are wrong or any less of a Christian or a Methodist or what have you. I want you to hear that from me. And if you ever have any questions or want to have any further conversation about anything we talk about, I hope it was implied, but I want to explicitly state that you're welcome to get in touch with us. You know, if you send the church an email or give it a phone call, Kyra, our lovely administrative assistant, will pass that through to me, and we'll get in touch. That is something I am constantly inviting you to do, so please take advantage of that. I just want to get out in front of that, because being on the internet, you see all the comments that get posted on what you put out. And I wanted to be able to just kind of nip that. I wanted to get in front of that and understand that we're both on the same page here, that I'm going to be approaching this text maybe in a different way than you do. But that doesn't mean that you are any less wrong or that I am any less wrong. I'm just hoping that I can turn this gem so that you see it in a different light. So let's begin. Jonah is a prophet because God calls Jonah to give God's message. That's essentially what prophets did. That's who they were. They weren't really prognosticators. They weren't really good weathermen. They didn't predict the future. They had a message that God gives them, and their job was simply to go where they needed to go and give that message. And so Jonah's message is against the people of Nineveh. And if I was Jonah, I wouldn't really want to go to Nineveh either, because Nineveh is a big city of the Assyrians, and the Assyrians are not friendly people, especially to the Hebrews. In fact, it's the Assyrians that will subjugate the northern kingdom. And in history, just talking about the Assyrians in general, what we have of their records of their warriors and how they treated prisoners, not very nice. Not very nice. Just very brutal examples of what the Assyrians would do to you. So, if I was Jonah, I wouldn't really want to go either. And so, Jonah hears this, and what does Jonah do? Jonah runs away. He gets on a boat, and he tries to sail in the opposite direction. God finds out, and a storm comes. And the fishermen, not Hebrews, important to note, foreigners, on this boat are, oh God, something's happened. Why is there this huge storm? And they kind of look at Jonah because, you know, Jonah's the Hebrew in this story, but to them, he's the foreigner, so they circle around him, and they go, what have you done? Because we didn't expect this kind of weather, and Jonah states, well, I'm running away from God. And the foreign fishermen, who should have no loyalty to the God of Israel because they are their own people who have their own religious duties to worry about. So in Jonah, in a story we find in Hebrew literature, we would not expect the fishermen to be faithful. We would not expect the fishermen to have to act and believe what the God of Israel is doing. But here we find that the fishermen are more faithful than Jonah, God's prophet. And so the fishermen go, well, how do we make this right with God? And Jonah says, throw me off the boat. And so the fishermen actually speak to God, don't take this against us. We're just doing what he told us to do. And they throw Jonah off the boat. And then the story is actually super interesting. Because chapter 1, verse 16, and what I've got in front of me here. At this, the men greatly feared the Lord, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord, and they made vows to him. So Jonah gets thrown off the boat, the weather calms, and then the fishermen make vows and sacrifices. They become believers. And so Jonah's in the water, and he gets swallowed up by a big old fish, and Jonah says a very eloquent prayer in the fish and is spat out on land. And we come to where what the text that Will read for us this morning, right? That God calls Jonah again to give this message to Nineveh. And at this point, Jonah's kind of learned his lesson, if you will. And he says, okay, fine. And Jonah goes to Nineveh, and he proclaims his message in 40 days. 40 days. Nineveh will be overturned. To understand why this is so weird, we have to actually look at prophetic work throughout our scripture. I'll just settle on one example, and that is we have a huge book in our Bibles opposed to Jonah, the book of Jeremiah. And it follows the life of the prophet Jeremiah as he proclaims a pretty similar message to Jerusalem. And Jeremiah is not received nearly as well as Jonah. Jeremiah gets the nickname Terror on All Sides. Like, he is the ultimate Debbie Downer. There is no good side to Jeremiah. It's just all doom and gloom all the time. They just, in some ways, they kind of laugh off Jeremiah. And in a lot of these cases, and because we have so many prophetic words calling for the same acts of justice, the same repentance and return to God's paths of righteousness, we have so many prophets that proclaim good news on behalf of the poor and call on the rich and powerful in society to make things right. It points to us that most of the times the prophets were not really listened to. That most times their calls fall on deaf ears. But this time, Jonah's story is not like those. Jonah hits it out of the park. He gives his message very short, 40 days, and then it will be overturned. And the people listen. The people mourn greatly, sackcloth, ashes. They fast. The king pronounces a fast. I haven't said this yet, but maybe it has occurred to us that the people who didn't listen to the prophets of our scriptures were Hebrews. The prophets typically proclaimed God's message to the Israelite people. But Jonah's giving his message to Assyrians. We talked about the fishermen in the boat, how they're foreigners, right? So they don't have any obligations to the God of Israel. You know, they could go either way. The Assyrians are foreigners, so everything that applies to the fishermen applies to them. But the Assyrians here aren't just neutral foreigners that we can kind of, okay, well, if they don't, whatever. The Assyrians are the enemy here. Trying to think of a good example, it would be like, you know, if Jonah was American and he was sent to North Korea, right? And the whole time he's like, I don't want to go to North Korea. And God's like, well, you're going to Pyongyang. And so eventually he gets there and he proclaims a message and, you know, Cleveland didn't listen to Jonah, but Pyongyang did. It completely blows everything up. And what happens? So Jonah makes this huge journey. He has succeeded where other prophets have not been as successful, as in he gives his message and the people hear it and they repent to God. They take it earnestly and take actual steps to make it happen. And how does Jonah react? He's furious. How dare these Assyrians listen to the message God gave me? In fact, it's so bad. Jonah gets so angry he wants to die. It is better for me to be dead than to be alive, Jonah says. And Jonah holds out some hope that maybe in 40 days, God will level the city of Nineveh because they're the enemy, remember? And so the story ends with Jonah kind of getting out a little plot of land for himself. He makes himself comfortable. He gets a little camp out ready. And he just sits and he waits. He waits for Nineveh to fall. And God grows a vine and gives Jonah shade. But Nineveh is not destroyed. But on that last day, God sends a worm to eat the vine over Jonah's head. And the wind picks up and the sand gets in Jonah's face and the sun blazes like it's never blazed before. Jonah is now hot and sweaty in the desert, and Jonah says his now second time famous line, I would rather be dead than alive. And so God now interacts with Jonah. God says to Jonah at the end of chapter 4, do you have a right to be angry about the vine? I do, Jonah says. I am angry enough to die. And the Lord says, you have been concerned about this vine, though you did not tend it or make it grow. It sprang up overnight and died overnight. But Nineveh has more than 120,000 people who cannot tell their right hand from their left, and as many cattle as well. Should I not be concerned about that great city? The book of Jonah ends with that question. That's actually just how it ends. Should I not be concerned about that great city? So I want to just cover the steps. Again, we have a prophet of God, someone who is supposed to take God's message and give it and be faithful to that. The first thing that prophet does is not that, runs away, tries to shirk his responsibility, and he finds himself on a boat with foreign fishermen, whom at the sight of God's anger in the form of a storm recognize that the God of Israel is not somebody to be trifled with. And they toss Jonah overboard. And after, build an altar and make sacrifices, make vows. The foreigner fishermen are more faithful than God's chosen prophet. And so then Jonah finally makes the trek. He's swallowed up by the big fish, and maybe in some of your stories, a whale. And he makes it to Nineveh, and he proclaims his message in one of the greatest turn of events, against all the odds, the enemy of the people of Israel, not just foreigners, but the enemy listens and they repent. And the prophet, having heard his message actually taken to heart, is furious and wants to die because somebody listened to his message and took it to heart. And so he just sits and waits. Hopefully, maybe God changes God's mind and destroys Nineveh anyway. And we have just a little repetition of the similar story, right, where the vine comes and is destroyed, and Jonah becomes so angry over something that is outside of his control, over God's actual will happening, that he wants to die. And then the lesson comes in. Right, this would be kind of like the end of if you read an Aesop's fable, how Aesop would explain the story to you afterwards. We get kind of a little bit of this here. These elements stand out to me, these reversals in character roles. This is what stands out to me and makes me believe that the book of Jonah is satire. Why is that important? This series, we're talking about creativity and how God can use different ways and different forms of literature to impact us. And so a question earlier that I posed to myself was, why does it matter then if you don't take it literally? If Jonah actually wasn't a prophet, what's the point of this? And so the answer to that, having looked at Jonah and looked at the satirical elements and the reversals and the exaggerations, would be to say that God can breathe life, right? We believe Scripture to be God-breathed or inspired. Not just through historical nonfiction, that other works, other creative works as well, can show us who God is, what God is about, and how we in partnership relate to that, and in a way, who we are called to be. What's so interesting is if we continue to look at more prophetic work, that the prophets are supposed to repeat verbatim God's messages, it strikes out to me every single time, in most cases, so I shouldn't say every single time, but in most cases, God speaks in poetry. So that stories that may not be true can still reveal to us an awful lot about who God is and what God plans to do with us and our lives. And in the case of Jonah, We can talk about the easy ways we see creativity, because God does a lot of creative things to get Jonah eventually to do what he's supposed to do. Jonah runs into a myriad of different people who react much differently, more faithfully than he does. All of them are foreigners. Some of them are Jonah's worst enemies. Some of them are people Jonah wants to die, and when they don't, Jonah would rather die. But each of those groups of people not necessarily teach Jonah, but they show to us how we are supposed to live and interact with God. The fishermen see how God is acting in their current circumstances, and they do what they have to do to make it right. Similarly, the people of Nineveh hear God's message and they repent. They put on their sackcloth and their ashes, they fast, they mourn, they do what they have to do to make things right with God. And so, as Christians, as people who would typically see ourselves as the ones called by God to do things, as we are looking at creativity and how God's creativity can present itself in our lives and what we do with that, I'd like us to start looking at people we least expect. To people who we don't think have the same kind of moral obligations that we do. To the people we would almost look down on. To the people we would consider even our enemy. And begin to ask ourselves the question, for what purpose has God put them in my life? Because it was the people we least expect in Jonah's story that taught us about who God is, how God is merciful, how God is compassionate towards people we would not be compassionate towards, how God cares for 100 and some thousand people who are the enemies of his chosen people, just as he cares for the vine that gives us shade. And it is also those people we least expect that show us how we ourselves are supposed to act in God's call. So let us look for those people. Let us see how God is creatively showing us who we are, who we are meant to be, and what we are meant to be doing. Amen. Siblings, my prayer for you this week is that you will be a little more like Jonah. Not that you will shirk your responsibilities, not that you will try to run away to a far-off place, but rather that you will look towards the most unexpected people in your life to see how God is creatively inspiring you to do what you were called to do, to be who you were meant to be, and to further understand who you are. Made in love by a God who loves you just the way you are. So go now in the name of that God who has made you in love. Go now in the name of Jesus Christ, who saves you through grace. And go now in the power of God's Holy Spirit that will strengthen and sustain us until we meet again. Amen.